Okay, the hope, after you get the videos.
Okay.
The English role, can you get that in this?
Ready?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, good morning, everyone. My name is Imro Sachdev. I'm from Radiology Department. So the topic for today's discussion is acute appendicitis and its mimics and the role a radiologist plays. So I've tried to keep the discussion as general as possible, not going too much into radiology. So my talk would be divided into these headings. I'll talk about the introduction first, then the role of imaging in acute appendicitis, some criteria and appearances for diagnosis. I'll talk about some pitfalls and some complications of appendicitis, and finally some conditions which can mimic appendicitis. So vermiform appendix, it's a vestigial organ. Our body doesn't need it at all. And it's called so because it looks like a worm, and it arises from posterior medial aspect of the cecum, where the three tenia coli, they converge and meet together. So the length is variable in individuals. It can range between 2 to 20 centimeters. So the appendix has its own mesentery, this small thing you see here. It's called mesoappendix, and its own artery in it. It's a blind ending tube. So obstruction of this blind ending bowel loop, it results in inflammation. So the causes of obstruction may be fecal matter or lymphoid hyperplasia, or even worms and parasites in tropical countries like mine. So typically a patient presents to the ER with right lower quadrant pain. So it's a very, very common presentation in any ER, and everyone who's worked there is familiar with that. So regardless of any other symptom or lab results, it is supposed to be considered as acute appendicitis unless it is proven otherwise. And this is a condition which needs surgical management, and any delay in management may result in complications and thus added cost of healthcare. So clinically, the peak age of occurrence of acute appendicitis is in young people. Peak age is 10 to 30 years. However, it can occur in older people and even in younger children, and even in infants, it has been reported. So the patient complains of a dull generalized abdominal pain, which migrates and settles in the right lower quadrant over the first 24 hours. So there will be low grade fever, nausea, vomiting, guarding and rebound tenderness. There will be clinical signs like obturator and psoas signs. The labs will show elevated white blood counts. So the complications are common in this condition, and they are time dependent. And then we have some clinical probability criteria also. There are some scales which signify the pretest probability of appendicitis. Like one of them is an Alvarado scale, which is from 1 to 10, and it can be used in ER, and it is used widely over many places. So then radiology acts as a link between the emergency room and the operating room. Ultrasound is usually the first line imaging, mainly because it's widely available and it's cheaper. And the sensitivity in various studies has been reported widely. It has been reported as low as 45% and as high as 98%. So it's a little dicey to consider it as the best investigation, but it is no doubt the first line investigation. So it can diagnose appendicitis, or it can provide an alternate diagnosis. And if appendix is not visualized and no alternate diagnosis is provided, the exam is labeled as indeterminate. We cannot rule out appendicitis on the basis of ultrasound alone. So the next logical step is the CT. If ultrasound is indeterminate, we go for CT. So overall, radiology's role is to reduce the morbidity and unnecessary surgeries. And overall, it decreases the cost of healthcare. At least that's what we aim to. So the patient comes to the ultrasound room. This is how the machine looks like. And this is basically the probe we like to examine the patient with. It's a linear probe. It's a high frequency probe. So its penetration is less. It is more suitable for superficial structures, but the resolution is high. So appendix being a superficial organ, it will be visualized well with this kind of probe. So we use this technique called graded compression technique. Graded compression means that where the patient points that I have pain here, we start the examination from there. And we give a firm and gradual compression with the probe. So the purpose is to displace any gas-filled bowel loops which may be superficial to the appendix. So they are displaced and appendix is visualized clearly. Most of the times we'll find some pathology where the patient points that he has pain. So a normal appendix is, this is the textbook description. It's small, easily compressible, concentrically layered, mobile, blind ending, and a sausage-like structure. So the normal diameter is less than 6 millimeters. Outer to outer means we include the muscular wall in this, and it's not just the lumen. The lumen is usually collapsed, or it may contain little fluid or air in a normal appendix. There is no hypervascularity on Doppler study, and there is no surrounding inflamed fat. So this is something a normal appendix looks like. It's a linear, blind-ending, sausage-shaped structure. The diameter here is 3.4 millimeters. But life is not so easy. We hardly see normal appendix. So on ultrasound. This is the textbook picture of acute appendicitis. We see this and we can safely label it as acute appendicitis and send the patient back. So the graded compression technique is used as discussed. So this is the description of the acute inflamed appendix. It is blind ending. It becomes aperistaltic. It is non-compressible. You cannot compress it. And this is, these two are the main differentiating features from small bowel. The diameter is mostly more than 6 millimeters, average of 9 millimeters, and it is hypervascular. The wall appears hypervascular on Doppler study. There is surrounding fat inflammation. There will be fluid and mesenteric lymph nodes. And many times we do see an appendicolith, which may be causing the obstruction. So this was a case, and here you can see the appendix diameter is less than 6 millimeters. It was 5.7. But it is inflamed, it is edematous, there is a lot of mesenteric reaction around it. So this was an acute appendicitis. So exceptions are always there. Some pitfalls on ultrasound. First of all, false positive. It's not so common to have false positives. It's only seen if a normal appendix, which is more than 7 millimeters in size. The reason for that could be in children because of lymphoid hyperplasia, or in adults due to fecal impaction in the appendix. Or it can also occur due to some other disease like cecal malignancy or Crohn's disease, and that is because of sterile accumulation of mucus. So we have to rely on the other signs, the secondary signs, look for inflammation, fluid, compressibility, vascularity. All the other signs help us make the diagnosis. So false positive is usually not a problem. What the problem is false negative. The most common cause is inexperience of the operator. Then the position of appendix tip is variable. The base is fixed at the base of the cecum, but the tip can actually go around anywhere in the abdomen. So these are some known positions. Retrocecal is the most common. It could be pre-ileal, post-ileal, pelvic, subhepatic. So it can be found anywhere. Even in a case of malrotation, it can be found in left lower quadrant also. But then it would be entirely different clinical story. So another reason is that you see a proximal normal appendix, but you miss the distal inflamed part. So the key is to trace it till the tip. Look for the blind ending loop. and then it may be inflamed but less than 6 millimeters, like the case I showed you. So in that case we have to look for other signs. Then if the patient is obese or if there are hard stools in the colon, so in those cases graded compression becomes difficult and the appendix may be too deep to be visualized on ultrasound. Then if perforation has occurred and peritonitis has set in, all that inflammation will obscure the appendix. Sometimes a radiologist sees an ovarian cyst and just attributes the cause of pain to that and reports it as ovarian cyst, does not look properly and misses the appendicitis also. This was a case, he came here on Monday actually, so I was able to get this pitfall from here only. I did this ultrasound. He was a 21-year-old male, obese, and it was a relatively early onset of pain. He presented in about 5 hours and he was in ultrasound room. There was no probe tenderness. Probe tenderness is a term which we use during the graded compression. We also look for clinical tenderness and it gives us confidence to build the diagnosis. There was no probe tenderness during graded compression. The ileum and cecum, they looked normal. So this loop which I have stored the image of is the ileal loop and it was showing normal peristalsis. And if you see the fat around it, there is not much inflammation going on. So appendix was not visualized in this patient. I was not convinced that it could be appendicitis. But then the junior doctor in the ER thought that there could be something and she ordered the CT. And on CT, we see the appendix. It's nice, enlarged, inflamed, some fat standing around it. So in retrospect, if we see the appendix was lying deep to that loop of ileum. And yes, there is a lot of fat which was obscuring it. But then it's whenever we have a doubt, we do order for the CT. But it's your clinical acumen also. If you feel that there is something, go for a CT, don't hesitate. So the role of CT, when you're in doubt, go for a CT. If the findings are equivocal, go for a CT. Obese patient, difficult to visualize, go for a CT. Clinical suspicion remains the decisive factor. No other factor matters. And on CT, the diagnosis is fairly straightforward. You will see an enlarged dilated appendix like here. There will be some enhancement in the wall. And as here we can see, there are appendicolids, which are the cause of the obstruction. And there is fat standing in the surrounding mesentery. There can be some reactionary free fluid also. So secondary signs, there could be some lymphadenopathy and small bowel obstruction also. And these are the basic criteria on CT. So if we compare the two modalities, so I'll first talk about ultrasound. Ultrasound is a low cost investigation. It doesn't really matter in Iceland, but in rest of the world, this matters a lot. So, and it is free of radiation. So you don't want to expose young adults and children to so much radiation. Then the negatives are that it is technique dependent. The results are difficult to reproduce among two examiners. And the other factors like position of the appendix or the patient obesity, whatever, they play a role in this. Normal appendix is generally not seen. So it is difficult to rule out appendicitis. CT, however, on the other hand, is independent of technique. It is not influenced by any local factors. The diagnosis of complications and alternative diagnosis is more confidently made on CT rather than ultrasound. The normal appendix can be seen and appendicitis can be ruled out. It consumes little time. It takes less than a minute to perform a CT. But the negatives are the radiation and the cost involved. So judiciously weigh both the options. And if the diagnosis is made on ultrasound, it's well, good and fine. Otherwise, one should consider getting a CT. So judicious use of available imaging modalities is the key. So it's better to choose radiation exposure and higher costs than to have someone undergoing an unnecessary surgery or a perforated appendix. So it works that way. Now coming to complications. The complications are common and they are time dependent. The more delay in diagnosis and management, the more chances of having the complications. The commonest is the perforation. The obstruction leads to accumulation of inflammatory fluid inside the appendix to such an extent that it has to escape by just perforating the wall of the appendix. So you see an irregular asymmetric contour of appendix, loss of the layer structure, and there could be some free air and fluid also around it. Then there is a term called phlegmon or the periappendiceal mass. So when the inflammation is going on in the appendix, the surrounding omentum, it tries to go there and encircle the appendix basically. If there is an imminent perforation, it tries to seal it off. So with time, this becomes a hard mass and it can be difficult to operate with such a condition when a mass has formed. So this is managed conservatively. And then appendiceal abscess, it is a frequent complication of perforation. It's a walled off collection which collects around the site of appendicitis. This may need to be drained percutaneously if it is larger in size. And then secondary bacterial peritonitis can always be there. It is more common in children as compared to the adults. I can show you some pictures. This is an ultrasound picture of a perforated appendix. You can see this is the appendix and the posterior wall has given way. And in continuation, there is a collection. This is the same finding in longitudinal view. The posterior wall has a defect in it with surrounding collection. This is an abscess on ultrasound. So it looks like this. There is this collection with echoes within and a thick wall around it. On Doppler, you can see it has inflammatory reaction, so hypervascular. This is the appearance of the abscess on CT. Here you can see a collection with a surrounding thick enhancing wall in the pelvis, and this was a complication of appendicitis. This is another case, appendicular abscess, well-defined collection in the close proximity to the cecum. And this was this case, appearance on the ultrasound. This was an interesting case. It was referred by Sigi. So this is a young male. He had an inguinal hernia on left side, a known case. And then there was clinical suspicion of an inguinal hernia on right side as well. And he came for CT. So what we saw on CT was that here, this is the femoral canal, if you can appreciate, and inside it is the appendix. So slightly lower slices and you can see the appendix coiled up in the femoral canal. So this is a femoral hernia containing a non-inflamed appendix. It's known as de Garangiot's hernia after some French surgeon. So the peculiar thing about this one was that all the literature that I searched for shows images where there was appendicitis. It was discovered after the onset of appendicitis. So it was diagnosed here before appendicitis and the patient had a surgery and prevented any future pain or complications. It's a very, very, very rare condition. And similarly, if appendix is seen within an inguinal hernia, it also has a special name. It's called amiant hernia. Now, in the last part of my talk, I'll be speaking on the mimics, the other conditions which can appear like appendicitis clinically. It's a long list. I'll go through quickly one by one. First of all, the mesenteric adenitis. It's a benign and self-limiting cause of mesenteric lymphadenopathy, mostly seen in children. So on ultrasound, you'll see a cluster of lymph nodes like this one. And it's the second most common cause of right lower quadrant pain after appendicitis. There is no management needed for this. It's self-limiting. So for this, again, normal appendix should be visualized for a confident diagnosis, which is many times not the case. So we rely more on secondary signs. Then bacterial ileocecitis, it's an inflammation of the small bowel, more commonly the terminal ileum, and sometimes extending to the cecum. The common causative organisms are Yersinia, Salmonella, and Campylobacter. So here the patient may present with symptoms just like appendicitis, or there may be some different and less acute symptoms. There would be diarrhea, and there would be a slightly longer history of pain, and we can confirm the finding with stool culture. So on CT, as you can see, there is a thickening of the terminal ileum as it joins the cecum at the ileocecal junction. So secondary findings would be moderate lymphadenopathy, and there would be very little surrounding fat inflammation in bacterial ileitis. However, clinically it may become indistinguishable from acute appendicitis, and here CT plays a role in making the diagnosis. So point to add here is that even appendix may be inflamed secondarily here. So it's the overall picture then, whether to operate or not, whether there is more generalized inflammation, or does it look as if it is starting from the appendix and then spreading to other parts of the bowel. This is a relatively rare condition, epiploic appendicitis. So the epiploic appendages, they are small fat protrusions which arise from the serosal surfaces of the colon. So these can undergo torsion, resulting in ischemia and secondarily inflammation. It mimics appendicitis if it's located in right lower quadrant. So in the image here, you can see it's here. There is a central fat density, the black thing, and then surrounding thin enhancing wall. So this is a typical picture of epiploic appendicitis, and it's lying in close relation with the descending colon. It is best visualized on CT. The appearances have been described in ultrasound also, but it is difficult to make a confident diagnosis on ultrasound. Even this is a self-limiting condition and needs conservative management. So if you diagnose this, you avoid an unnecessary surgery in a patient. Next is the omental infarction. Sometimes the fatty tissue of the omentum, it undergoes infarction in right lower quadrant, and it can mimic a pain which is indistinguishable from appendicitis. So on imaging, you see a cake-like mass, inflamed mass, as seen here. And it also contains fat in the middle, but the only difference from epiploic appendicitis is that this is usually larger than in size, usually more than 5 centimeters in size. These two conditions may be indistinguishable, but how does it matter when they're both going to be managed conservatively? Then right-sided colonic diverticulitis. It's a fairly common condition in the Western world. Most commonly the sigmoid colon is involved, but the cecal or ascending colon diverticulae, they are not rare as well. It is more likely to affect the older patients. So if a patient is above 40, this diagnosis has to be kept in mind. So there is inflammation of pericolic fat on CT along with thickened colon wall at the site of a diverticulum. So usually you should see a diverticulum in the center and a lot of inflammation going on around it. So here this white thing you see is the diverticulum of the cecum, and there is inflammation around it. So, and in such a case, you can also scroll down and look at the appendix separately. And usually they are managed conservatively, but sometimes there is formation of abscess which may need drainage. Then the Crohn's disease, it's a common inflammatory bowel disease. It's a long-standing and chronic condition. This is one of the typical findings of Crohn's disease. You can see there is transmural bowel wall thickening, which is generalized. And then there will be all sorts of secondary signs. There would be fat inflammation, and there would be free fluid, lymphadenopathy, increased vascularity. Usually the patients are known case and they come to ER due to exacerbation of the symptoms. But the initial presentation can mimic appendicitis and it can result in diagnostic dilemma. Then there are certain gynecological conditions in females which can mimic appendicitis, like pelvic inflammatory disease, then a painful hemorrhagic cyst, then there could be torsion of the ovary. The underlying cause could be a cyst or a dermoid or any other mass lesion which can result in torsion of the pedicle of the ovary, or there could be ruptured ectopic pregnancy. So not only in the right lower quadrant case, every female patient of reproductive age group should be inquired about her LMP in ER, because pregnancy related complications are common. So this image is an ultrasound image of ovary which has undergone torsion. So it looks bulky and it looks hyperechoic like this, and if you use Doppler, there is no vascular supply within the ovary. Then a little bit about some other conditions, like ureteric calculus. It can, although it has a typical presentation, but it can be confused with appendicitis sometimes. A non-contrast CT should settle the matter. And then very rarely there is rectus sheath hematoma, which, as you can see in this image, there is a hematoma in the right rectus muscle in the lower abdominal wall. So usually the patient would be on an anticoagulant, and it occurs due to bleed from the inferior epigastric arteries usually, or there may be some history of trauma or some any other underlying condition. And again, CT will be helpful in making the diagnosis. So with all the mimics and complications, we've seen that CT is a much better tool than ultrasound. So again, I would emphasize that ultrasound is just for seeing if their appendix is inflamed or not. Otherwise, CT gives the answer to everything. To conclude, it's a common cause of right lower quadrant pain in emergency room and needs surgical management. And then radiology plays a role in confirmation of diagnosis most of the times, but it is not free from pitfalls. And we try to provide an alternative diagnosis as well. CT is a logical next step if ultrasound is inconclusive. And a number of non-surgical conditions can mimic appendicitis, which should be kept in mind. And they can easily be ruled out on a CT. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you for a very nice lecture. And I think you have both contrast and non-contrast CTs.
Yes.
The ordinary CT for appendicitis would be without contrast.
It would be an intravenous contrast study. Although there are different regimen adopted in different places, some people do go with non-contrast also. But with intravenous contrast, there are more chances of finding an alternative pathology as well. And then you can top it up with the oral or rectal contrast as well, depending on the condition. So a normal appendix will show opacification with an intraluminal contrast, while appendicitis will never show contrast within the lumen.
As a surgeon for 30 years, I've seen all of the pitfalls.
Yes.
You mentioned. And you showed us, for instance, the appendix appendicitis on the left side. It is most common on the left side, but then you have often the signs on the left side, but it is on the right side at the time that you can both go in for a appendicitis. So you said that well, this condition and the other one that is more rare, inflammation of the mesentery.
Yes.
That's a very rare question. I've seen that one twice, and this and that. I'm not so sure that you mentioned that the age should be who have a conservative approach.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm certain that in one of those cases, it was not wise to have a conservative approach.
Okay.
It was so extensive that it would have taken a lot of time and complication, not to operate and just take away a huge department. So it's not always a conservative approach that is impacting in these cases.
It's always comments from you that we learn from. Them. Thank you.
Thank you. Is this ever an acute investigation? Can these people wait to what comes in tonight?
Usually not. Usually they need prompt investigation, because with time you are just resulting in more chances of complications.
So, may I comment? As you mentioned so often in your clinical, and you say this in your report, I don't remember exactly where it's but clinical.
Correlation is advice.
So that means that in the beginning of the symptoms, when it comes to ER, clinical correlation is maybe the most important thing. So it's not always that it is necessary. If you have a very short history and not a very sick patient, you can wait till the morning. You don't have to call out every time for a meeting. You can do it in the morning sometimes. That is a clinical decision.
Yes. It always depends on the clinician, because we have not seen the patient. We have not seen you examine the patient. So. If you feel there is a high chance, we just corroborate. We don't go in a different direction. So you have to guide us to go in the right direction.
Yeah, I think you know, the colonoscopy, we see the appendiceal arteries.
Mm-hmm.
And they're very different. Some of them, very small, and the children get more appendicitis when it's a small rope than the adults. Actually, in fact, when I was trying to investigate pulmonary dependence by putting a ERCP catheter and injecting contrast in it, you just see it as such. So, the won't be both by children anymore.
Plus,
by school in that area.
Thank you.
Just some comments about the specificity of sensitivity. First of all, you see there's almost never a normal risk. But then that becomes a normal and it's so must be a
no. I've learned it the hard way. I wouldn't admit to that. A non-visualization of appendix doesn't mean it is normal.
And then the second comment is if two persons hardly ever visualize the same way,
mm-hmm.
then it must be very difficult.
Yes.
Also, it's just a general comment. It's almost in every presentation here. But how should you measure sensitivity and specificity? What is the gold standard to measure your games? Maybe it's not important whether the the name of the employer. So what you really need as a gold standard measure is this ethics is probably different. But you cannot get, then you have to have your hands behind your back and wait until the preference. So this component, you know, always this question about systems, think what is the gold standard.
Personally, I don't really believe in the statistics. That figure was just to show you the variability, the degree of variation we have got over different studies. So it's very, very different. It depends on the machine you're using. It depends on the probe you're using. Like where in Delhi, where I started to do my residency, in the ultrasound machine ER, we didn't have a linear probe. We use a transvaginal probe to diagnose appendicitis because it has higher resolution. So yes, there would be more chances to miss a diagnosis in such a condition. So it was only after 6 months or so that we got a new machine, and suddenly there was a spurt in the positive diagnosis on ultrasound. So it goes that way. There are many factors which it's very difficult to replicate the conditions in different settings and with different people doing it.
Final question? I'm sorry. We see chronic appendicitis. I believe there is a disease called chronic appendicitis.
Yes.
We've done surgeries on these people come in and out with chronic lower right quadrant pain and don't have acute appendicitis. Is there any radiological standard? In the old days, was it barium enema if the appendix didn't fill with barium and it was sort of sine qua non, then there's something wrong with it. Yes. What's today? What do we do today?
It's CT scan. CT scan. You will see mild fat stranding, and the appendix would be inflamed. There would be some degree of inflammation.
Even with chronic
and even with recurrent appendicitis. These are two conditions which do not present acutely, but almost always the answer to patient's problem is the surgery, appendectomy. So you can see some inflammation, correlate it with the chronic pain of patient, and just take out the appendix. Patient is cured.
Okay, then. Thank you.
Okay, thanks a lot.